They said, we have to call you water broken, strep B positive, and you're having high blood pressure. So I was like, man, this is not going the way I expected it to go. Hey everybody, it's Elle, and today I am doing my birth story. So I apologize ahead of time because this video may be interrupted by a baby. Gabriel Elias was born about 2 weeks ago, and he's still not great at like napping during the day, obviously. I mean, he's super little. So I just kind of put him in his swing and he's just hanging out like over there, but we'll see. I don't know if he's gonna wake up hungry, so we may be interrupted. And then the other thing I have to mention is this thing. Yes, unfortunately, I picked up the car seat in the wrong way the other day. I don't even know how exactly it happened, but I sprained my wrist. And so I have to wear this for a little while. So just if you guys are wondering, like, what happened to her wrist, that's why that's going on. Okay, so last time I talked to you guys, other than, like, announcing that Gabriel was here, I was doing my bump date for you guys and saying that I had been having contractions on and off. Basically, I was having prodromal labor, which I had actually never heard of before, even though, like, I'm a nurse and like, this is my world and I should have, like, understood what was going on. And I even asked my midwife at my 39-week appointment, I said, at what point do we call this prodromal labor? And she's like, oh, well, you're not there yet because the contractions you're having aren't that strong. Well, she happened to see me when the contractions weren't super heavy, so I was kind of like, okay, and then me and my husband got in the car and my husband was like, I love your midwife, but she has no idea what you're talking about because your contractions are intense when they happen. And I was like, I know. So we just kind of went from there and went home, and that was that. So I had been having contractions on and off for about a week, and what happened is we were going into a weekend, basically, and I was like, you know what, I'm gonna try acupuncture. I've tried all these different things, not necessarily to jumpstart labor or induce labor, because I wasn't due technically yet. I was still like a couple days away from being exactly 40 weeks. So it was like right after I made my 39-week update, basically. And so I went in for acupuncture, and they said, well, because we're not going to induce you, we're just going to do some points for like general well-being and help you feel a little bit better. And yeah, I mean, it felt good to do acupuncture and it was relaxing, but I definitely like continued having prodromal labor for the next 2 days, and the contractions weren't as, now that I've experienced like labor contractions, they weren't as intense as true labor contractions were, but they still were intense enough that I was really having trouble sleeping. Like, I would wake up, have a contraction, and like try to go back to sleep. I was taking a combination of Tylenol and Benadryl, which was recommended to me by the midwives to try to sleep at night, and that usually worked. Also, like, eating big meals sometimes would help, but really there's nothing that, like, would start or stop these contractions, which made me think they were not Braxton Hicks. So nothing was stopping these contractions, and it had been the weekend, and the acupuncturist said, well, when you're actually due, come back and we'll do points to help you induce labor. And so I did that on the day that I was due, which is a couple days later after the weekend and after just, like, these sleepless nights and whatever. I finally went back in, and I had acupuncture done to help induce my labor, because I was like, at this point, it makes sense for me to naturally induce because I am just not sleeping, like, this is horrible, and my body's obviously trying to go into labor and just cannot. We didn't figure out until afterwards why that was. So what happened is, so they did the acupuncture, and while I was in acupuncture, I was like having strong contractions all day. So my husband drove me because I was like, I don't think I'm safe to drive right now. Like, you need to drive me to acupuncture. So he did. And like, while I'm sitting in the chair, I'm like breathing through contractions with the acupuncture going. I sat there for about 45 minutes, and then I was done, and yeah, the contractions just kept building stronger and stronger. And later on that night, so I had my appointment at like 1 p.m., and then later on that night, real strong contractions started happening. When I say real, I just mean like really strong. And so, still in prodromal labor at this point, and they're starting to get so intense that I'm becoming very vocal. Like, at this point, hypnobirthing is definitely helping. But it's not like you know, I'm not, like, tranquil like you see in some videos and things like that. I definitely could not get my head in that space, so that was tricky. So I'm starting to have really intense contractions. I'm becoming very vocal, and my husband is, like, massaging my back in between during the contractions, and, like, we're doing our best to get through them, and it wasn't very long. I think I was having these contractions for about an hour, and I was like, we need to call the midwives, because this is definitely more than just prodromal labor at this point. Like, they're coming every 3 to 5 minutes. Hey guys, sorry, somebody woke up from their nap and decided they wanted a snack, so I will finish my birth story while nursing. So at this point I was like, we need to call the midwives. So I called the midwives, and they were like, well, let's see if you can wait another hour or so. And then, like, while I was talking to them, I put down the phone and had a contraction, and they're like, okay, yeah, those sound pretty strong. So why don't you wait 1 hour, and we'll plan on meeting you at the birth center in about 2 hours, because it's about 45 minutes away from us. Of course, it was like 10 o'clock at night, so it really only took like 30 minutes to get there because there was no traffic. It's on the other side of Boston. So yeah, so we were like, okay, that makes sense. So we start packing up the car, I'm getting through the contractions. I call my dad, who lives about 3 hours away, and I said, hey, you might wanna start heading down. And I said, you know, labors can take a long time. The average labor is like 18 hours, so don't rush. But it was like 10 o'clock at night, so I said to him, you know, maybe consider coming down like tomorrow afternoon, just start getting your stuff together, because he had to like pack and figure out where he was gonna stay and all that good stuff. So we go to the birth center, and my contractions are strong at this point, but for some reason they were starting to peter out, and I was like, come on. So we get to the birth center, and they're like, you are 0 centimeters dilated, and I could not believe it. I was like, how in the heck am I having contractions this strong, and I'm 0 centimeters dilated? So anyways, they're like, you need to go home, yada yada, and I was like, okay. So we go home. The car ride home was okay. We get home 20 minutes after being home. Like, we stopped and got, like, got some, like, sandwiches and stuff like that, because usually, like, a big meal helps to stop the contractions when they were before. And I take Benadryl and Tylenol. Nothing works. 20 minutes after being home, I eat, like, half of my sandwich, and I'm, like, working through these contractions. And I get to the point where I am very vocal, and, like, I call up the midwives again, and I'm like, look, I know I'm not dilating, but this is a problem because these contractions are extremely strong. I'm definitely not going to sleep through these. What do I do? And they said, come on in, and we'll just, like, monitor you and make sure that everything's okay. Because obviously at the birth center, they had just kind of, like, done a really quick check of, like, his heart rate and stuff like that and my contractions. But, you know, they wanted me to come into the hospital part, which is, like, across the street from the birth center. Still run by the midwives, which is amazing. So I come in and I see the midwife again. And this time, my contractions are strong and I am, like, vocal. Like, we're driving to Cambridge, and I am, like, basically screaming in the back seat. It was not the hypnobirth tranquility I was expecting. Not to say that can't happen, but I think I was, like, definitely a little bit panicky because I knew that I wasn't dilating and these contractions were extremely strong. So we get there and they put me on the monitor, and they're watching me, and they're like, okay, yeah, like, obviously, you're not faking, like, obviously these are very strong. They put me on the monitor, they can see that the contractions are very strong. His heartbeat's looking fabulous, though. So they say, all right, we're just gonna spend a night here in observation. Like, basically, they gave me a little bit of, like, pain medicine, and it really just kind of made me sleepy, and they're like, we're just gonna have you try to rest and see if these contractions continue or what happens. But when I got there, which was literally, it was an hour and a half in between when we had left the birth center the first time and when we got to the hospital, I was 4 centimeters dilated before they admitted me. So they were like, even though you're 4 centimeters, clearly, like, you're in early labor, we usually would send you home even though you're 4 centimeters, like, usually want you a little bit further along for the birth center, so they, because they kind of just want to catch the baby at the birth center. So anyways, So they're like, but obviously, like, you're extremely uncomfortable, and we should just, like, keep an eye on you because we don't want you to have to go back and forth a bunch of times more. It's not good when you're in labor to be in the car for that long and stuff. And so I was just like, okay, I mean, not good, like, medically, just it sucks being in the car when you're in having really intense contractions. So they hooked me up to the monitor, and I'm definitely, like, starting to progress, and the medicine they gave me made me sleepy, so I was able to sleep a little bit and rest a little bit, and in the morning I had progressed. I think I was like 6 centimeters dilated, so they're like, okay, you're in active labor. But the problem was originally I was strep B negative, and then if you guys remember, if you watched my other videos from my bump dates, I had a UTI early in pregnancy, and that UTI had strep B in it. And so they said that trumps the strep B negative test you had, so we're calling you strep B positive, and you're going to need antibiotics every 4 hours, so I was a little bummed by that. And then the other thing they said is, over the night, you had some high blood pressures, and, you know, we're not saying definitively what that is, but because of the high blood pressures, we're just going to keep an eye on you here, and I couldn't go to the birth center yet. So they keep an eye on me, working through labor, we keep our hypnobirthing affirmations on. I put it on Bluetooth, so we had a little Bluetooth speaker that was playing tranquil music. They also said they couldn't tell if my water had broken or not at this point because they did a test, and apparently I just had a lot of, like, discharge down there from just being in late pregnancy, early labor, and they couldn't definitively say if it was my water broke or not. They did, like, several of the tests, but they couldn't really, it was, like, borderline. All the tests were borderline. So they said, we have to call you water broken, strep B positive, and you're having high blood pressure. So I was like, man, this is not going the way I expected it to go. So they said, unfortunately, in, like, so many hours, we're gonna have to start Pitocin because your water's broken and whatever. But, you know, these midwives are amazing, and they're like, and I said, can I try some alternative methods first? And they were totally on board. So so I got out my little manual breast pump. We used that. I started some clary sage oil, which is like essential oil that I put on a diffuser in the corner. We had my hypnobirth affirmations on. We were doing acupressure. My husband was like massaging me during the contractions. And we were a team. We were working through labor. We were doing really well. And then, unfortunately, I was not progressing, and my contractions were getting stronger, but I was not actually progressing. Like, the baby wasn't getting lower, my cervix was not dilating yet, or it wasn't dilating more, so they said, unfortunately, we're going to have to start Pitocin. They said, the other issue is you're continuing to have high blood pressures, because they take it every 4 hours or so, and they said, so we're going to have to do a urine test to make sure you don't have preeclampsia. So I do the urine test, and they have to start Pitocin, and I literally, when they said I had to start Pitocin, I literally cried, because I looked at my husband and I said, there goes my natural birth. There goes me not wanting an epidural, all this stuff, because I knew with Pitocin, not just like a little bit of Pitocin sometimes people need, but like a continuous IV of Pitocin, those contractions are, excuse my language, just hell. And they're way stronger than normal labor contractions. They're longer, they're more intense, they come more frequently, and so I just knew. I was like, there goes my natural birth. But I was like, you know what, but we're gonna just keep going. We're gonna keep working through it, we're gonna do our best. So they do the urine screen, they come back and they say, your urine test was borderline. But because of your high blood pressures, and at this point I was having a lot of swelling, they said, you are preeclamptic. You have preeclampsia, which means we cannot obviously have you deliver in the birth center, and there's kind of like a ticking time bomb, basically, in my uterus. The way to fix preeclampsia is to deliver your baby. And at this point, I had been in prodromal labor, and then I was in labor for, like, active labor for, you know, a day and a half or so, and we were starting to progress, but just really, really slowly. So, again, so they were doing Pitocin, we were doing the clary sage oil, the acupressure, we were using the manual breast pump, and we were rocking through labor. They offered me, and then I think it was, like, 3 hours into Pitocin, the contractions were very, very strong. And I said, is there any other options for me other than obviously like an epidural? Like sometimes, you know, hospitals will use like laughing gas or whatever. And I had that for my wisdom teeth surgery and it didn't really do anything for me, laughing gas. So I don't know if it even works on me, but I was just like, what are my options at this point? Because I am just miserable. And then because of the preeclampsia, I couldn't get out of the bed. So that was really troublesome. But at this point, the midwives were being so amazing. And they're like, we can't really let you out of the bed, but if we have a midwife with you, like, right next to you, we can let you sit in, like, the tub, which is in the bathroom, but it's not, like, a birthing tub. It's just a regular standardized tub. And I told them, I was like, you know what? I tried a tub earlier in this week, and it actually made me more uncomfortable because I couldn't really fit in the tub. Like, I was so big and pregnant that I just... standardized tubs just wouldn't fit me, and it was uncomfortable because like half my body would be cold and the other half would be warm, and I was just like, I think that's just going to make me more miserable. What other options do you have? And so they offered me basically this medicine that just makes you they told me it would take the edge off, but it would probably make me kind of tired. It wasn't morphine or any like narcotic. It was basically, I described it as super Benadryl. And that's what it was. It did not take the pain away. It did not take the edge off. In fact, I think it was my breaking point because it was so strong of a, like, sleepiness inducer. And also I had been not sleeping well beforehand that I literally, as my husband would describe it, is I would be snoring asleep, wake up, have a contraction, be screaming through the contraction, and then go back to sleep. And that was happening every couple of minutes. And yeah, it was miserable. That was not something I would encourage anyone to take. So anyways, so I got through that. And then as it was starting to wear off, because it only worked for about 2 hours, that's what they told me. And I said, well, 2 hours is fine because I'm nowhere near to like about to be delivering this baby. So if I'm like super, super tired, it's not that big a deal. And if it takes the edge off, that might be enough to get me through without needing an epidural, because before they gave me the medicine, they checked me and they said that I was 8 centimeters dilated. So I was like almost at transition at this point. And I was like, if I can just get a little bit of something to take the edge off, then I won't need an epidural. And that was my big thing. I did not want one. I have scoliosis. I didn't want to mess with my back. So I was just like, yeah, we're just going to try this. Big mistake. At the end of the 2 hours, I think I was still at like, actually, they did not check me again. So at the end of the 2 hours, I basically was like, I'm done. I need an epidural. I can't do this, because I was literally sleeping, waking up, screaming, and sleeping again. And I had no time to like prep. Like, I feel like with hypnobirthing, you need to be relaxed. And I had no time to get in a relaxed state before the contraction would happen. And I was just a mess. And I was like, I just can't do it. The Pitocin was making them so strong and right on top of each other. So I was just like, I'm done. I can't do it anymore. But I was proud of myself. We got through 5 hours of Pitocin with no epidural. So I was really proud of myself at that point. Also at this point, it has been like 25 hours of active labor. So I was pretty exhausted. So they come in and they do the epidural, and the anesthesiologist is really sweet. And she's like, do you know you have a curve in your back? And I'm like, yes. And in my head, I'm like, please don't make that be what disqualifies me from getting this epidural. But she was able to do it. And it did bring relief to my stomach. I still felt everything down there, which I'll get to for pushing. And I have some relief for about an hour and a half. We put on some nice music. I'm able to relax. We take a little bit of a nap. And then I started feeling lots of pressure down there, and so I paged our midwife, which at this point in all the shifts of midwives we've had, it's actually my midwife, the one that has seen me through my whole pregnancy and before I was even pregnant, which was just so amazing. And so she came in and she said, all right, well, when you feel like tons of pressure, that's when we're gonna push. So I waited until I felt tons of pressure. And then she came in and checked me, and she said, yep, like, baby's in the right position, and you're fully dilated, so we're getting ready to push. And she had me do a practice push, and she was happy with it. And then all hell broke loose. So at this point, too, so I have preeclampsia. They need to get the baby out. And you know, I was really lucky that I was being observed by midwives, because I think the second I had preeclampsia, if I was with an OBGYN, they would have just been like, all right, C-section time. So we do a practice push, and she's like, all right, let's get into position. So she calls everybody in for the delivery, and she has me, I was like, can we try some more upright positions to help get him out? And she was open to that, but she said that his head was just like a little bit stuck under my pubic bone or something like that, so I needed to lay down for some of them to try to get him in a better position to come out. And so unfortunately, I was in a laying down position the whole time, because once I was laying down, I could not sit back up. So I was laying down, and we started pushing, and I realized very quickly that the epidural was working for my stomach, but was not working for my nether regions. And oh my gosh, I could feel everything. And what I learned in hypnobirthing was a lot of the like pain you get down there from delivery is like pushing, basically, like rushing your pushing stage. But the issue was I had to rush my pushing stage because his heart rate was great the whole time. And then as soon as we started pushing, he started having a high heart rate, and he was clearly in distress. And I had preeclampsia, and we were a mess, and they were basically like, he needs to come out right now. And so I had to push him out because, you know, I'm glad that I didn't have to have a C-section, but it was like almost down to that. So I'm pushing him out, and I could feel everything down there, and the issue too was his head did not cone, because he came out quickly when he finally did decide to come out. And his hand was also on top of his head like this. So I wound up delivering not only his head, but his whole arm at the same time. So there wasn't a whole lot of room down there. And so I don't want to get too graphic, but you know, or scare anybody, but that was definitely the most painful experience of my life. The contractions at the end of labor were not that bad compared to the amount of pain I experienced getting him out of my body. and I knew that it would have been better if I was able to slow down my second stage, which is the pushing stage, because there was like one contraction that I didn't push through. I said like, I just need a break. And they basically were like, you can't take a break, but I like wound up missing a contraction anyways. And when I was contracting, my body was doing the work, but I wasn't pushing and it didn't hurt as bad. So I knew that like hypnobirthing, at least I think got that part right, that like you won't feel as much pain or ring of fire or whatever, with second stage if you kind of let your body do the work. But because he was in distress, it was either like, he needs to come out or we're having a C-section right now. So, or I'm having an episiotomy, which I would have felt as well, because I had all my feeling down there. And so, so that was extremely, extremely painful. And I had a lot of damage, and I don't think anyone, all the midwives and nurses that were in the room were really coaching me and doing their best. And I remember one midwife that was so nice when I first was admitted was now like, basically saying like, since I got in the room, you've gotten a lot more vocal. You haven't done a whole lot of pushing, and which was like really discouraging to me, because I was like, I wanted to say like, I'm doing my best, but you don't understand what I'm feeling down here. And I don't think anyone believed me until they were stitching me up afterwards and were like, holy cow, okay, so you did have a lot of stuff going on down there. And if anyone's wondering, the damage that I had down there is I had a third degree tear on the bottom half of me, and then I had a tear up top, and then I had tears on both sides. So four directions there, and that was very, very difficult. But so we got him out, and he had meconium. So the issue was, before I started pushing, my water still hadn't technically broken. They felt a bulging bag of water, so they said, oh, your water hasn't broken. But remember, it was borderline before. So they broke my bag of water, and it was clear. It was when I was pushing that he released his meconium. So it was like an end game situation, and he came out, and he was on me for about, I'd say, 30 seconds, when they realized he wasn't breathing right, and he was like covered in meconium, and he wasn't like blue, but he was pale. He was pale and like, I'd call him brown because he was covered in meconium, which is like blackish tinged, and he was pale. So he looked brown to me, which was crazy. And I remember my midwife saying the cord stopped pulsing and like, we need to cut it so that we can examine him. And at first I was like, can we wait a little longer? And then she basically was kind of like, no. And I was like, all right. So they cut the cord and they whisk him away. And that's the last I saw of him for 3 hours, which was also terrifying. So they bring him over to the warmer and he's having trouble breathing. So they're suctioning out meconium. And meanwhile, like, I delivered the placenta just fine. And it was like literally minutes after he came out that I delivered the placenta, which was like so funny to me. It's usually like a lot longer than that. But yeah, so they do a whole bunch of stuff on him and they're like, we have to bring him to the nursery. Like, he's not doing well. So they had to bring him to the nursery. And I was being stitched up for about 2 or 3 hours before I was finally like, I need to go see my baby. I haven't even seen him. It was funny, when he first came out, the 30 seconds he was on my chest, I was like, you know, what is, like, who, like, what is it? Like, what gender is the baby? Because we had been waiting. And they were like, look yourself. But he was still, like, slippery, and I was laying down. And so I had to have, like, my husband look. And I don't even think he said, it's a boy. I think he just said, it's Gabe, which, like, makes me cry to this day because we had said we weren't going to name the baby until we had spent some time with the baby and, like, knew what the baby's name was. But I had just known my whole life that I was going to have a baby named Gabriel. And I, as you guys knew, I predicted this was a boy the whole time. And, like, my whole family and friends all thought that it was a girl. So I thought that was really funny, and I just kept saying, I know it's going to be a boy, and I know his name's going to be Gabriel. I just know. And my husband the whole time was like, all right, well, we'll see. And so it was like, my husband was the one that was kind of on the fence about the name. He wasn't as sure as I was. And then as soon as, the second he was out, he just broke down and was like, it's Gabe. And so that was his name. It just was, that was his name. Like, there's no other way of describing it. So that was amazing. And it was a very sweet moment until they had to whisk him away. And so that was really tough. And then he had to spend a couple days in the nursery because he had a lot of breathing problems because of the meconium. And it was really hard because you could tell he wanted to nurse. Like, he was ready. He wanted to nurse. My body wanted to nurse him. But they couldn't let him nurse until his breathing was better because they didn't want him to aspirate, which is like, basically sucking in, instead of sucking in air, you suck in like liquid or food or whatever. So they didn't want that to happen. So we had to like spoon feed him literally with these tiny little spoons. We like, I would pump colostrum and, or like hand express colostrum into these tiny little spoons. And we'd like literally pour it into his mouth and give him like a finger to help him suck it down. And just like be very, very careful, or use like a syringe. They did syringe feedings with him, like using a little needleless syringe and like literally squirting drop by drop of either my milk, or they had to give him formula at one point because my colostrum wasn't quite enough and he was burning so many calories by breathing so fast because he was having trouble. And it was just really, really hard those first couple days because, you know, I don't think I experienced any, like, postpartum issues, like depression or anxiety, but I definitely, it was really hard to be separated from my baby, and it's just not what I expected at all. Like, you know, I was really hoping for, like, a calm water birth and hypnobirthing, and I wound up having preeclampsia, and I kind of felt like my body betrayed me a little bit, and then he had trouble, and it was just, it was hard being separated from him. He was in the nursery and I was in a room down the hall so I could like go and visit him, but it was still hard because the nursery is locked and so you had to like knock on the door, and there were times where I'd go and knock on the door and they'd be like, oh, we're working on another baby so we can't like have you come in right now. And that was just really hard. So there was a lot of really tough moments in those first couple days, but I'm so happy that he's here. And on the plus side, breastfeeding is now going amazingly well. I feel like he was just made to nurse. Like, he was ready from the start. He just couldn't. And then as soon as he started feeling better, I think it was like day 3 of his birth, after his birth, he was 3 days old, and they said, okay, you can try nursing, and he just did awesome. A little trouble, like, latching at first and stuff, but he did amazingly well. Sometimes we had to use the nipple shield, sometimes not. And then I remember right before we were getting ready to finally leave to go home as a family, and I tried nursing him, and he did amazingly well, like without a nipple shield, without anything. And I think that was one of my like sweetest moments ever with him. It was just me and him. We were both in like street clothes, not the hospital gowns, and he was able to wear clothes because at first he had to be naked with nothing but a diaper on because of all the monitors hooked up to him. And then we were able to finally just lay there in the hospital bed and nurse, and it just felt so natural and right. And it just was like, after infertility and then feeling like my body betrayed me from preeclampsia, and then him having trouble, and it was finally like coming all together, and it was just so wonderful. But yeah, it was great. And I was gonna do placental encapsulation, but unfortunately the hospital messed up and they put my placenta in formaldehyde, which really upset me at the time. But looking back on it, I now have such an intense milk supply that I probably wouldn't have been able to take placenta pills anyways because they increase your milk supply, and I would have had issues with that. So it all wound up working out for good, and everything's going great. He's a little fussy this morning, but once we get everything all situated, I'll come and do another update for you guys. I'm going to do a review of my Freemi pump, which, by the way, I love. So if anyone's on the fence about the Freemi, oh my gosh, get it. It's so worth it. Mine was free through insurance, but it's, oh my god, it's such a lifesaver. Pumping with your clothes on, you have no idea. I have a lot of family and friends that have been visiting, and there have been times when they're like, guys, I need to pump, and they're like, oh, and I'm just like, nope, and I just like slide it into my shirt. I'm like, you're good, you can stay where you are. And so that's been amazing. Get yourself a Freemi or an adapter. I'm not paid by them to say this. I just absolutely love it. And recovery's been slow for me. I'm still very sore, but everything's going okay. And that's it for now, guys. I will talk to you soon. I can't guarantee when videos are going to be up or if they'll be anywhere close to on time, because as you can see, he's a little high maintenance, and he takes up a lot of my time. And so I can't guarantee anything, but that's it for now, guys. And if you like, subscribe. Bye!